As we all come to terms, try to come to terms, with the unthinkable tragedy that occurred in Bondi Junction over the weekend, many parents have been left feeling unsure about how to talk to their children about what unfolded. Where do you even start that conversation?
Yeah, now, whether they witnessed the incident firsthand or watched it on the news or maybe saw something on social media, this morning we're breaking down the best way to reassure kids during times of uncertainty and distress.
Now, for more, we welcome parenting coach Genevieve Muir, who also specialises in grief and bereavement. Genevieve, nice to see you.
Okay.
Most parents' instinct would be to completely shield their children from what happened, but the reality is these shopping centres, this is where we go. We go to the movies, we go for ice cream, we go for dinner. This is very much a part of family life. So where do we start?
It's so close to home for all of us, and our instinct might be to completely shield our children. But just like we saw the image of that incredible dad who covered his kids' eyes with those eye masks, we do want to shield them from unnecessary images that might be too much for them to process. So if we can limit our news and for older kids their social media so that we can take charge of the conversation, that's going to go a lot better for our kids.
Okay, so even if they haven't seen the news with their own eyes, kids do have this, I'm going to call it like a radar.
They
for detecting
sure
when something's off.
They
or
do.
They notice that the parents are talking about something, maybe not including them, but they overhear things.
Yep.
So how can you give them context? Yeah, as we're all still processing stuff.
Oh, look, and I feel for all of us right now are processing this, and it is so massive. I think it's okay for parents to take a beat, to process it themselves, talk to someone else yourself, think about what you want to tell the kids. And then when we do go in to have that conversation with our kids, we want to be really sticking to the facts at an age-appropriate level and being really clear and direct with what we do say.
What if the kids are asking just straight-up questions like, am I safe? Should I be worried?
Yep.
Will this happen again? Can I go to the mall with my friends? Where do we start with that? How do we respond?
Yeah, kids' immediate question will be around their safety, and I think one of the best places we can start, whether your child is 5 or 15, is by asking them, what have you already heard and what are you wondering? When we start with that curiosity, we find out where they're at. Sometimes they've been misinformed about something by a friend, or they've overheard us talking and they've misinterpreted that. So we want to get right to that as our first port of call, and then we're really being as factual as possible, depending on our child. I've had many, many parents contact me this morning saying, my child's really anxious. I know they'll be terrified if I tell them the facts. So we've got to keep in mind who we've got, really stick to those facts, be clear and direct, and allow space for them to ask those questions. We want it to be an open conversation.
Mm. And if they say, Mummy, can I go to the mall now? Are we going to be safe? What would you say to that?
I'd first validate that emotion. Mm. I'd say, do you know what? I can totally understand why you feel scared, and we feel sad too. We all do. And that makes sense. And then once we've really heard that emotion, we're able to say, this is such a rare thing in Australia, and here are the ways that we can keep you safe. And we move on to focusing on that safety.
Okay.
We just don't want to jump there too quickly.
Okay. That's good.
So kids are going, you know, we're at the shops last weekend with Mum and Dad. We're outside Cotton On. We went to Cotton On where this has happened. We walked past Boost Juice. That's all on the news there, right? So if you sense that your child is struggling with this, not understanding what to do or how to process.
That's right. And often our kids won't just directly walk up to us and say, hey, I'm struggling, I'm worried, I'm scared, I'm sad. What they will do is show us through behaviour.
So we've got some red flags here.
Yeah,
so
we
what
do.
To look out for.
Absolutely. So one of the things we look for is behaviour that changes. So kids that are suddenly struggling with going to bed or they're picking on their sibling, we might tune into that and say, I can see you're having trouble with your sibling and I'm wondering if you have questions about what we spoke about earlier. So we're looking for that. But in terms of red flags, if our kids are struggling to eat as normal, sleep as normal, they don't want to go into activities they would normally do, that would be a sign that we want to talk to someone outside the family. That can be a school counsellor or even a GP is a really good place to start if you think that your child is struggling a little bit more than other kids are.
And you know what? It's not just the kids who are struggling.
Oh. Completely.
It's adults too. So maybe a wider message for older people who may be watching today.
Completely. For all of us, it's about being kind, starting with self-compassion. It makes sense that we feel really sad. This feels really close to home. Thinking about compassion, not just for ourselves, but for others, all of the people laying those floral tributes. I saw Maggie Dent today posted a floral tribute from Canada on her social media, thinking about ways we might want to give blood. We might want to think about that, something that we can offer in terms of making that world a better place. And I would say to anyone today who's with with their kids, getting out in the sunshine and just, you know, sitting with your kids and being with them can be a really good way to ground after something like this.
Because it is school holidays in New South
Wales. It sure is, yeah.
Genevieve, thank you for coming in.
Thanks for having me, guys. If